Before the end of 2042, a specific narrow area of California has an incredibly high chance, and I mean slightly upwards of 80% in my opinion, of being struck by an approximately magnitude 6 earthquake. Normally, predicting such a high likelihood of a moderate or strong quake striking in less than a 20-year-long timeframe isn't possible. And yet, for a peculiar 37-mile-long stretch of the infamous San Andreas Fault, we can make a much higher quality prediction of sorts. What I'm referring to is the region stretching from a lobe that begins a part of the Pancho Rico Creek, running southeast through Parkfield, all the way to 2.6 miles southeast of the community of Cholaim. It might seem unscientific to claim that this region has a high likelihood of being the site of an approximately magnitude 6 earthquake at some point in the next 17 years, but let me show you the intriguing historical record. You see, earthquakes along this 37-mile stretch of the infamous fault line regularly occur between magnitudes 5.5 and 6.5 in a semi-regular pattern. Such earthquakes occurred in 1857, 1881, 1901, 1922, 1934, 1966, and then, most recently, in 2004. With each quake in this magnitude range striking between 12 and 38 years apart, you can see where I arrived at my 2042 figure as the latest date if and only if it continues to follow this pattern. The next quake in this range might occur even later than 2042, but for now, that seems far less likely. But why does this specific section of California produce these larger magnitude earthquakes on a fairly regular basis? The answer relates to how the specific stretch of the San Andreas Fault behaves, acting differently than the entire rest of the fault line, which has made it a hotspot for scientists to study. While almost the entire San Andreas Fault is locked, building in strain until it is released via an earthquake, primarily via its northern and southern segments, its middle segment is a different story. This middle segment around Parkfield is instead slowly and continuously moving in a manner that does not produce earthquakes via a process known as fault creep. This very process is occurring in between Bitterwater and Parkfield. Yet, if I said that this process creates no earthquakes, then how did it create the magnitude 5 and 6 range events we are discussing? The answer is that not all of the middle segment of the San Andreas Fault is creeping, just most of it. In between the more numerous and larger creeping sections, there just happen to be a series of many smaller lock sections. And since these lock segments are consistently not very long, and the length that can rupture on a locked fault is one factor that constrains the magnitude of an earthquake, this region ends up with fairly frequent moderate magnitude earthquakes. However, the model I am showing here is not truly scientific since it does not show an accurate mile-per-mile creeping versus locked state of the San Andreas Fault. It is merely being shown so you, my viewers, can understand this concept. As for why these regular magnitude 5 and 6 range earthquakes are sometimes striking a bit southeast of the edge of the middle segment, I theorize that subsections of it are also creeping in between similar length lock segments, almost like a residual and less prominent effect of the more northwestern fault section. The good news is that these so-called Parkfield earthquakes have seemingly so far not caused any deaths or injuries, and in the past only caused at worst moderate damage to a few structures. As a final note, I want to add that one of my contacts theorizes that a similar situation to the middle segment of the San Andreas Fault is also occurring on a portion of Indonesia's Malanu Fault, creating similar magnitude earthquakes on a fairly regular basis. The Matanu Fault is also a strike slip fault that represents a tectonic plate boundary. I would now like to thank my YouTube channel member Donald Saunders for supporting my work.